and she conceived by the Holy Ghost.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Behold, I have made of the Lord.
Be it done unto me according to thy word.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. And the Word was made flesh
and dwelt among us.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Pray for us, O Holy Mother of God,
that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ.
Let us pray. Pour forth, we beseech thee, O Lord, thy grace into our hearts, that as we have known the incarnation of thy Son, Jesus Christ, by the message of an angel, so by his cross and passion we may come to know the glory of his resurrection. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In nomine Patris et Filii Spiritus Sancti. Amen. In tuoi volontari Dei, et benedifica juventutum meum. Iudica me Deus et discerne causa meum de gente non sancta, ab nomine nene quodo nosso orrome. Quae tuus Deus fortitudum, quare repellistit quare tristis in cielo, dum infligimen. Emite lucem tuum veritatem tuum, insieme de lux erunt, de lux erunt in montum sanctum tuum, in tabernacula tua, et in tuoi volontari Dei, de inquiritifica lumen tutum meum. Confidebuti vincitere a Deus, Deus meus, fetis anima mea, quare conturbas me. Sferen Deo, quam me toco fidebo iri, salutare vultus me, et Deus meus. Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto, sicut erat in principio et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. In tuoi volontari Dei, ed inquilitifica juventud meum. Auditor nostrum in nomine Domini, qui feci celum et terra. Confitium Deum potenti, beata Maria, sempre Vergine, beata Mutare, Canto, beata Maria Baptiste, Sancti Sposti, Spiritus Pauli, beata Maria, Maria, via, nomibus Sancti, Bubis Frates, quae pecami in miscogitazione, verbo et opere, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa. Ed eo prego, beata Maria, sempre Vergine, beata Mutare, Macandolo, beata Miguel Baptiste, Santos vos spectre Paul. Beatum Noire Maria Vianum et Santos vos fratres, orare con me Domino nostro. Miseria tutti uini potens Deus et mis peccatis tuis peccutate vita eterna. Amen.
Confitio Deo omnipotenti, beatum Maria sempre Virgini, beatum Michael Arcangelo, beatum Ioanni Battiste, Santis Apostolis Petrus Paolo, Omnibus sancti et divinitate, quia peccavi minis cogitatione, verbo et opere, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa. Ed eo prego beata Mariam, sempre Virginem, beatum Michaelem Arcangelum, beatum Ioannem Baptistam, sanctus apostolos Petrum et Paulum, omnes sanctos et te, Pater, orare pro me, ad Dominum Deum nostrum.
Miseria tuvesse, nipotens Deus, et mis peccatis vestis, peducat vos et vitam aeternam.
Amen.
Indulgentiam assumptionem et remissionem peccatorum nostrorum tibi, et nobis omnipotens et misericus Dominus.
Amen.
Deus tu conversus perfectabis nos,
et Deus tu eletabitur in te.
Os sede nobis Dominus misericordiam tuam,
et salutare
tuam dat nobis, Domine exaudirationem meam,
et clama meus et te veniam.
Dominus obiscum,
et cum spiritu tuo,
ordemus. Os justi meditabitur sapientiam et lingues loquetur judicium lex Deus in corde ipsius, noliam iulani maninansibus, neque salveris facientis iniquitatem. Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto, sicut erat in principio et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. Os justi meditabitur sapientiam et linguae eius loquetur judicium, lex Deus in corde ipsius. Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Christe eleison,
Christe eleison,
Christe eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie
gloria in excelsis Deo, et in terra pax omnibus boni voluntatis, laudamus te, benedicimus te, adoramus te, glorificamus te, gratias agimus tibi propter magnum gloriam tua. Domine Deus rex celestis, Deus Pater omnipotens, Domine Filii unigenite, Iesu Christe, Domine Deus agnus Dei, Filius Patris, qui tollis peccatum mundi miserere nobis, qui tollis peccatum mundi suscipe deprecatione nostra, qui sedes dextram Patris miserere nobis. Gloriam tu solus sanctus, tu solus dominus, tu solus altissimus Iesu Christe, cum Santo Spirito in gloria Dei Patris. Amen. Pax vobis,
et cum Spirito tuo.
Alleluia. Sancti Bruno omnis confessoris tui ad quaesmus Domine, et intercessionibus adjuvemur, ut qui me statum tuum gravite delinquendo offendimus, eus meritis et precibus nostrorum dilectorum veniam consequamur. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum Filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Amen. Lectio Libri Sapientia. Beatus vir qui inventus est sine macula, et qui post haurum donabit, inexperavit in pecunia recta osaris, quis est hic et laudabimus eum, fecit enim mirabilia in vita sua, qui probatus est in illo et perfectus est, erit illi gloria eterna, qui potuit transgredi, et non est transgressus, facere male et non fecit, id eo stabilitas sunt bona ilius in Domino, et elemoisnis ilius enerabit omnis ecclesia sanctorum. Deo gratias. Iustus ut palmo florebit, sic ucetus Libani multiplicabitur in domo Domini, annunciandum ane misericordiam tuam et veritatem tuam per noctem. Alleluia, alleluia, beatus vir qui sufer tentationem quodiam, cum probatus fuerit accipi et corona vitae. Alleluia. Dominus vobiscum,
et cum spiritu tuo,
sequentiae Sancti Evangelii secundum Lucam,
gloria tibi, Domine.
In illo tempore dixit Iesus discipulis suis, sint lumbi vestri precinti et lucerne adentes in manibus vestis, et vos similes hominibus expectansibus Dominus suum, quando revetatur ad nuptiis. Ut convenerit ecus averit confestem apparriant Dei, Beati servi illi quos conveneri Dominus in veneri vigilantes. Amendigo vobis, quod precincetse et facit illos discumbre, et transiens ministrabit illis. Et si venerit in secunda vigilia, et si in tertia vigilia venerit, et iter in venerit, beati sunt servi illi. Hoc autem citote, quoniam sis cerit pater familias, quam ore for veniret vigilare tutique, et non sinerit perfodi domum soam. Et vos est toti parati, quae aqua horre non putatis filius hominis veniet. Allaus tibi Christi. On this, the feast of Saint Bruno, priest and confessor and holy abbot. The lesson is taken from the Book of Wisdom. Blessed is the man who lives unreproved, who has no greed for gold, puts no trust in his store of riches. Show us such a man and we will be loud in his praise. Here is a life to wonder at. A man so tested and found perfect wins eternal honour. He kept clear of sin when sinful ways were easy, did no wrong when wrong lay in his power. His treasure is safely preserved in the Lord's keeping, and wherever faithful souls are met, his alms deeds will be remembered. And the Holy Gospel today is a continuation of that according to St. Luke.
At this time, Jesus told his disciples, "Your loins must be girt and your lamps burning, and you yourselves like men awaiting their master's return from a wedding feast, so that they may open to him at once when he comes and knocks at the door. Blessed are those servants whom their master will find watching when he comes. I promise you he will gird himself and make them sit down to meat and minister to them. Whether he comes in the second quarter of the night or in the third, blessed are those servants if he finds them alert. Be sure of this, if the master of the house had known at what time the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and not allowed his house to be broken open. You too then must stand ready. The Son of Man will come at an hour when you are not expecting him." Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Carissimi, beloved in Christ, welcome to this broadcast Mass on this, the Feast of St. Bruno, abbot, priest and confessor. Born approximately in 1030 AD in Cologne to wealthy, sort of noble family of the city. He began an education that eventually led to Reims and to the Bishop's School, the cathedral school there, where he continued his studies in theology and philosophy, becoming quite an accomplished scholar. His studies completed, he returned to Cologne, where he was given canonry, Saint Cunitis, I think. Can't quite remember now, sorry. But was made a canon and was priested in the year 1055. In 1056, the saintly Gervais, Bishop of Reims, recalled the former pupil Bruno back to Reims to become head of the Episcopal School, where he was not only headmaster of the cathedral school, as it were, but also of all the educational establishments in the Diocese of Reims. Eventually, after 20 years almost service there, in 1075, bishop died. Sorry, in 1070, the saintly Bishop Gervais died, and a new bishop, Manasses, became bishop. In 1075, In 1075, Bruno became Chancellor of the Diocese of Reims. So formerly cathedral school headmaster, head of all religious education in the diocese, and then in 1075 was made Chancellor of the Diocese. In 1077, the saintly Gervais dies and Manasses is made bishop. Manasses was a complete contrast to the saintly Gervais. Instead, he was much more of the kind of 11th century noble son put into the church, who acted more like a temporal lord than a spiritual prince. He was very unpopular with the diocese, so that in 1077, Bruno had to lead, as it were, a petition and a delegation and denounce the bishop. This eventually, of course, case was taken to Rome for adjudication by Gregory the Seventh. However, Manasses was a friend of Henry the Fourth, the Holy Roman Emperor at that point, who was no friend of Gregory the Seventh. So, unfortunately, there was some nasty goings on. Manasses responded to the deposition by ordering the houses of those who had signed it to be taken down, etc. Anyway, eventually he was made to withdraw by the Pope, and the people of Reims, the chapter of Reims, the cathedral chapter, elected Bruno as the next bishop. But this was not what Bruno wanted whatsoever. So he determined to leave the cathedral city around the year 1080. By this point, in 1075, St. Robert of Molesmes had begun to found a small community of monks that would later become the Cistercian order. But Bruno and his six friends who went with him to try that life determined that it was not quite for them. However, in 1080 they went on, 1081 they went on to Grenoble, and there the saintly Bishop Hugh de Chateauneuf, a name I will soon not forget, as Chateauneuf is Chateauneuf du Pape is one of my favourite wines. Hugh de Chateauneuf, who was bishop of Grenoble and would later himself be a canonized saint, he had had a vision of a ring of seven stars that went from his town to the Alps and there rested above a place called Chartreuse. When Bruno and his six companions told St. Hugh of their plan to retreat, as it were, into the desert places and lead an eremitical life, immediately St. Hugh recognized that this was the answer to his vision. So it was that Bruno and his companions went on to Chartreuse and then led a very eremitical and very arduous existence. Some of you may perhaps be familiar with a wonderful film called Into Silence. It's available on YouTube for free in various different languages. The original is in French, but there are subtitles for what spoken dialogue there is in it, which is not an awful lot. But it exposes the life of the abbey at Chartreuse, and you can see the mountainous terrain, the precarious, almost as it were, situation of the monastery, and the changing seasons. And you can see how until the height of summer it is always, I would say, a very cool and windyish place. They were near poverty stricken most of the time, near starving, but they had resolved to live closer to God. They had resolved to adhere to, more literally, more closely, to the evangelical counsels of the gospel of poverty and chastity and obedience. And so they lived there in the tradition much of the Desert Fathers of Egypt and of St. Anthony, seeking that solitude, that loneliness, that oneness with God. However, this was not to last. The machinations of men and of the world, and perhaps even of God, Bruno was called away by a former pupil of his at the Reims Cathedral School, who had become Pope, no less. Indeed, Urban II, the saintly Gregory VII, having passed away. So it was that Urban II very much determined that he needed the help and assistance of his former schoolmaster to tackle the ever troublesome Henry IV. And indeed, he had to contend with an anti-pope at the same time, Clement III. So it was that in 1090, Bruno left Chartreuse, left that solitary and eremitical existence which his heart so desired, and was thrown back into, as it were, into the world of ecclesiastical and secular politics. Now, not very much is known concerning this period of his life, except that he was extremely influential within the papal inner circle. Not much is known about, perhaps, his direct influence, because he kept himself very much to himself. That is sage advice for anyone who is ever called to Rome, and particularly to work in the papal curia. He managed to keep himself at a distance and set apart, as it were, from the rest of the politicos and diplomats, and instead retained a position as a very private counsellor and advisor to his former pupil, the Pope. In 1091, however, he determined with a couple of companions to establish in the Diocese of Squillace, outside of Rome, another eremetical existence, near enough to Rome that he could be called when desired or when needed, but where he could himself retreat to, as would be necessary, much like our Lord Jesus Christ, who you may remember from the narrative of the Gospels, quite often would take himself apart, would take himself away to be with his Father. So it was that Bruno and his companions desired such a similar place. They were blessed to be supported by the Count of Sicily and Calabria, Robert, who ensured that the land upon which they had settled was donated to their cause. And there they built, near a chapel of the Blessed Virgin, a little monastery. So two foundations, two houses of Carthusian monks, as they would later become to know, to come to be known as. So there he dealt and assisted with Urban II until, of course, Urban died. Urban died in 1099. Then Landwin, his friend and first companion from Reims, who had followed him to Chartreuse and whom he'd left as abbot there when he went to Rome, he too died. Robert Mlesmer also died Robert of Calabria died in 1100, Urban in 1099, Landwin in 1100, Robert of Calabria in 1101, and eventually Bruno himself on the 6th of October in 1101 AD, dying in his cave dwelling, dying in his hermitage, dying at one and at peace with God. He desired that his remains were humbly interred. He had no desire himself, and I should mention that at one point he was offered the bishopric of Apulia, the archbishopric of Apulia, by Urban and Robert of Calabria, and that too he had turned down. So often when you see paintings, portraits of St. Bruno, you will notice often a mitre on the ground, quite often sort of leaning on its side, to make the point that he was, of course, an abbot, but also that he had refused twice the episcopate. He was very lucky in that regard. For others of us who have tried to do so have not always been so lucky. However, he was in 1623 canonized. It took so long, not because of the adulation of the faithful and of the clergy for his heroic virtues in his lifetime, but rather because his Carthusian brothers knew that such adulation was not what Bruno himself had desired. Eventually, of course, as things do, as orders grow and time passes further from their founders, so later on a petition was started for his canonization, as I say, which was willingly granted in 1623. But as to the adulation of Bruno at the end of his life, the practice of religious houses, particularly those of Benedictine inspiration, was when a monk died to send a scroll. Indeed, these scrolls contained all sorts of information, not just about deaths, but also about significant or important events in the life of a particular community. And these scrolls, which were great scrolls of parchment, would be begun with a message and then hung round the neck of a messenger who would be then sent to religious houses and places, centres of religious education and hierarchies and there the message would be passed on. And often, in the case of obituaries, people would write their own appreciation of the person who had died. So Bruno's scroll is one of the greatest examples of this. It was extremely long, even for that time, and contains no less than 78 witnesses, inscriptions, praising his humility, praising his wisdom, praising his charity, praising his spirituality. And not all of those who inscribed it had necessarily met him, but all noted, all had something to say, all had something to say about this man who, to all intents and purposes, had tried, as it were, to live a humble life, who had tried, as it were, to live away from the machinations of men, but who nonetheless had such holiness of life about him, and such wisdom, holy wisdom about him, and such an expression of charity and of spirituality rooted deeply in love of God through Christ, that nobody could allow the parchment to pass them by without saying a word, and many words. The scroll is very long. There are three things that are particularly noted concerning the spirituality of St. Bruno. Firstly, his great prayer life, a very dedicated man of prayer. He would always be found praying. And if we look at the life that has inspired the Carthusian monks ever since, their life is one of complete and utter prayer. If you're able, and I do recommend it, to watch the film about Chartreuse, you will note, though there is a cloister of the monastery, instead of cells, in the like that we see in Benedictine monasteries, and instead you see, almost as it were, little houses that the monks live in. And the cloister is often very large. Charterhouse cloisters are often very large. In Sussex, we are blessed, not so far away, at Park Minster near Cowfold, to have Park Minster Charterhouse. And there you can see a mile square cloister. Well, actually, you can't see it. You have to see it from aerial photographs, because it's very rare that they let anyone in to see the monastery up close. But you can see from aerial photographs this mile square cloister and these little houses with their own chimneys and their own little back gardens around that cloister. And the monks in a Charterhouse, rather unlike, as it were, their Benedictine forebears, live most of the time in those cells, and most of the time in those cells they are praying. If they are not praying, they are working, following the edict of St. Benedict, ora et labora. So if they are not literally in their stall, in their house praying, then they are in the garden attending to their vegetables or their plants and praying while they work. It is usually only one meal a day, or sometimes just a meal on feast days that they share together in a refectory. Otherwise, food is taken round, and in the cloister corridors, where the little houses come off, there's just a doorway. So they look like any other kind of cloister. You just see a series of doorways, except they are considerably spaced out compared to most Benedictine cloisters. And next to each doorway is a kind of dumb waiter, except that there is no elevator in it, but it is a little cupboard. And beautifully captured at Chartreuse in the film Into Silence is the monk who is on, or the lay brother normally, who is on food duty, on kitchen duty, who walks along the cloister with a trolley arranged with sets of silver, silver metal dishes or coverings over plates, or all stacked up, rather like those Indian takeaway lunchtime series of metal tins, you know, the ones I mean, in a stand that all go together. And he walks along the cloister pushing his trolley and stops every now and again, opens the door, as it were, to the dumbwaiter and puts in the food or the allowance. Or the other lay brother who's on the other duty, male duty, might say mail room duty, he puts in books or letters or whatever into those little cupboards. And then the monk, normally a priest, Carthusian monks, the fully professed monks, the choir monks, are normally ordained. So the priest in the cell then will open his cupboard from inside and take out the food and have his lunch or his breakfast. They come together usually only two or three times for prayer in the Abbey Church, usually for vigils, so usually very late at night or early in the morning, certainly for compline, for night prayer. They will come together for matins, for vigils, for Lourdes, for matins. They will come together, and maybe at midday, for the midday office, they may come together. And they will come together for Mass. And then they will sing. And again, we hear in the film about Chartreuse, we hear the wonderful chant. It's his, of course, Gregorian chant, and you'll see they still use these huge medieval manuscripts with the neames, the big square notes of music on the staves, beautifully illuminated pages, and the Latin text following, and there, of course, singing the psalms, singing the office, singing the propers and the ordinary of the Mass. Very little has changed in their way of life, having, as it were, kept themselves very much apart from the rest of the world, one might even say from the rest of the church, for so many centuries. It is a very inspiring film to watch. So prayer. St. Bruno was a great man of prayer. He was also a great one for mortification of the body, a great one for penance. Now remember our reflection about St. Francis of Assisi the other day on his feast day. St. Francis too was a great practitioner of penance. St. Bruno himself would mortify his body, attempting as it were to discipline his flesh, discipline that aspect of our incarnational being that is nearly always warring with our spiritual essence. The point of mortification of the body, of course, it's not very popular these days, well, not at least in a holy sense, but the idea, of course, is to subdue the worldly flesh and subdue those temptations due because of the flesh. And mortification is not just about whips and cilices, but also too about diet. It is also one of the ways of mortifying the body is through fasting. And of course, when we see with the ascetical life with St. Francis, and we see with St. Bruno, those who take to heart the vow of obedience particularly, we often see in connection with it a great aesthetic to mortification and to penance. In a sense, as it were, we might say it is a manifestation of that holy fear, that gift of the Holy Ghost, one of the seven of the gifts of the Holy Ghost, and a way of making present to the individual the ever presence of God. Because when you think about it, it is quite often the temptations of the flesh, whether carnal or whether of food, that distract us and take our minds away from thinking about God. And certainly if when you are attempting to pray or to meditate or to contemplate, most people I know, especially on retreats, etc., will find it difficult. You hear your tummy rumbling, you know, suddenly you become aware, suddenly all your senses, all your physical senses are heightened. You suddenly become aware of also any sound. A rabbit passes by and you think about rabbit pie because your stomach is rumbling, even though you may never have had rabbit pie or never eat rabbit pie. And certainly most and certainly Carthusians are vegetarians, but even so, that sort of thing. So mortification and physical mortification as an aesthetic is about as it were, making oneself constantly aware that we are in God's presence at all times. And thirdly, the third aspect of St. Bruno's spirituality was a great devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary. Every monastery, every charter house has as their principal co-patron the Blessed Mother. And of course, this is in part, I suppose, because all the professed choir monks are priests. And of course, as I've explained before, priests have a particular devotion, a particular connection to the Blessed Mother, for she is, of course, the mother of the priesthood, as the mother of Christ. As she who stood at the foot of the cross when our great high priest first offered Mass, or first culminated the sacrifice of Mass, of Calvary, of the Last Supper. So our Blessed Mother, Mother of Christ, Mother of our High Priest, Mother then of his priests, those who are called to be Alter Christus, another Christ in the ministration of the sacraments and the gifts of the Holy Ghost to the Church. In iconography, you will also often see St. Bruno depicted with a skull, which is again an aesthetic symbol, making one always aware of one's death, making one always aware of one's mortality. Memento mori, remember your mortality, reminding us that we are all due to meet an end of this life, and thus we should seek to live purposefully this life for the sake of that eternal life, won for us by Christ upon the cross. And so you will see Bruno always depicted with a crucifix, adoring a crucifix. And you will see him too often with a rosary. The rosaries in his lifetime were very rare. It was a very new devotion. And you will see him and his Carthusian, what became the Carthusian habit, the very long and full white tunic and scapula with cowl. And this spirituality of St. Bruno, we can indeed take elements of for ourselves. As we've reflected many times before, we are not all called to the religious life, and even within the religious life, those callings are various, to various different expressions of the religious life. Indeed, it's wonderful to think of the growth, of the inspiration and growth of the religious life from around the time that Bruno lived. If we remember, of course, that St. Robert of Milesmes, or Melemme, who founded Citeaux, which of course gave us Bernard of Clairvaux, so gave us the Cistercians, St. Bruno gave us the Carthusians. Later on, of course, in the in that 10th century of the 1100s, would be born Dominic de Guzman, who would of course become the founder of the Dominicans, and of course St. Francis, who himself would become the founder of the Franciscans. All these great, this great time of religious fervour, of religious inspiration for a deeper life, a more connected life with God. So there are elements of St. Bruno's life that anybody as a Christian can take. One, of course, is prayer. And to pray without ceasing, to pray even when working, even when doing the most menial of tasks. We are instructed by the Gospel, of course, to glorify God by our lives. Our Lord tells us to glorify our Father who is in heaven by the living of our lives. And to glorify God means, of course, to give everything to Him. To be always aware of Him, to have Him first and foremost in our minds. Remember, that is the first commandment. Love the Lord your God with all your mind, with all your heart, with all your strength. We should at all times be living, seeking to glorify God, knowing that He is always with us, always watching us, always there for us. And always ready, always to be engaged with us. And this is what the great ascetics teach us about prayer. To pray without ceasing. Prayer can be an ongoing conversation with God. And even when we are doing things, we can still be praising and worshipping and glorifying and speaking and sharing our lives with God. No matter what the task, no matter how menial. Some of you may remember my reference to the Litany of Our Lady of the Pots and Pans. Whatever task, there is nothing too menial that cannot yet give glory to God by our intention whilst doing it. And indeed, at every moment of our lives, in whatever scenarios and situations arise, turn to God first, not as a last resort. Don't pray as a last resort. So many people say, well, I tried this and I tried that and this didn't work and that didn't work and I asked so-and-so and they let me down and so-and-so let me down and then this happened and that happened and then I prayed. Yes, and then amazingly something happened. Turn to God first. Turn to God in prayer first. And you think of the life I've described to you of St. Bruno. There must have been many times in his life when he needed to pray, where he turned to God and asked God first. Mortification. Not popular. But indeed, my brothers and sisters, more of us could utilize such disciplines as fasting to enable us to be always aware of God around us. More of us should practice fasting and abstinence. Remember, these things are given to us by Holy Mother Church to enable us to grow in our spiritual lives, to enable us to become holy and fit for heaven. That is the purpose of our Christian life. It is tradition, of course, to fast and abstain from meat on Wednesdays and on Fridays. Not traditionally, very traditionally, of course, in Lent, but it's a good practice throughout the rest of the year. Do you know, at one time, we were supposed to fast like that all 40 days. Indeed, sometimes that was 50 days, and before that, 60 and 70. Remember, Septuagesima, Sexagesima, Quinquagesima. Over the centuries, perhaps Holy Mother Church has become more merciful, or perhaps we, as the faithful, have just become more lackadaisical. But fasting, prayer and fasting, notice in the scriptures, that especially if you read the lives of the prophets, and if you look at the life of the last prophet, of course, John the Baptist, we notice they led lives of prayer and fasting. And before any great event, there was fasting and prayer. Likewise, my brothers and sisters, we should practice mortification ourselves. Prayer and fasting, we could do more of it, and it would do us no harm. And would have greater benefits than most of the fatty diets that some of us attend. It would have not only physical benefit, but would also benefit the sake and salvation of our souls. And of course, we could all have a better and closer relationship with her who was so close to Jesus that she was in every sense spiritual and physical one with him. Remember Microchimera. Remember that as he was in her womb, so they literally became one flesh. That closeness of her to Christ should, my brothers and sisters, enable us to see and to recognize and adopt her ourselves as our mother. As her oneness in the flesh unites her to her sons in the priesthood. So to all of us who become children of God by adoption, by our faith in Christ, by our baptism, should also turn to Mary as our adopted mother. She who is the most holy Theotokos, the mother of God. For she is the mother of our salvation. So many downplay the importance of her fiat, of her response to God's will. No Mary, no Jesus. So remember Mary. Like St. Bruno, have a great devotion to her. Like St. Bernard, never be afraid to ask her intercession, particularly in difficult times. Like Dominic, meditate often on the life of Mary in connection with our Lord, but also to the life of Mary as a human and as a mother. We should all have greater devotion to the Mother of God. And we should all remember and look at the examples throughout history where those who ever turned to her and asked for her prayers, turned and asked for her intercession, were never, never let down. So, my brothers and sisters, let us with joy celebrate today this feast of St. Bruno, this man who shows us such love and such dedication for God, who expressed in his spirituality, that desire for oneness with God, which is the answer and the way in which our Lord's own prayer for us might be fulfilled for each and every one of us. He who prayed that all his disciples might be one with him as he is with the Father. Let us make that our prayer too, and the purpose of our lives, like St. Bruno, that we may become one with him, who is God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dominus vobiscum,
et cum spiritu tuo,
ordemus. Veritas meas misericordia mecum in so, et in nomine meus occavitur bonum eus. Seculorum.
Amen.
Un Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sus un corda.
Habemus sanctum Dominum.
Gratias agamus Domino Deo nostro.
Dignum et justum est.
Veri dignum et justum est equam salutari nos tibi semper et ubique gratias agere Domine Sancte Pater omnipotens aeterne Deus. Et Christum Dominum nostrum. Per quem est satutum laudat angeli adorando nationes tremunt potestates. Celi cerunque virtutes e beate serfim socis ut actione concelebrant, cum quibus nostris voces ut mitium est et precamur, supplici confessione dicendo.
Sanctus, 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 Dominus Deus Sabaoth, plenissum celi et terra gloria tua, Hosanna in excelsis. Benedictus qui venit in nomine Domini. Hosanna in excelsis.
nobis quoque peccatorium. Secula seculorum.
Amen.
Parnem, sprece di salutare vos moniti di fine istruzione formati, ademus dicere. Padre nostri, qui es in cieli, santificai tu nomen tuum, advenia regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum de nobis hodie, dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentatione. Se libera nostra mano. Per mia secula seculorum.
Amen.
Ex Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Deus Dei, ecce qui tollit peccato mundi.
Domine, non sunt dignus, ut in te subtectum meam, sed tantum dignabo, et se nobitur anima mea.
Domine, non sunt dignus, ut in te subtectum meam, sed tantum dignabo, et se nobitur anima mea. Domine, non sunt dignus, ut in te subtectum meam, sed tantum dignabo, et se nobitur anima mea.
Brothers and sisters watching Mass online or unable therefore to receive the Blessed Sacrament, we invite you now to make an act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that thou art present in the Blessed Sacrament. I love thee above all things, and I desire thee in my soul. Since I cannot now receive thee sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though thou wert already there, I embrace thee, and unite myself wholly to thee. Permit not that I should ever be separated from thee. Amen.
Thank you.
tu servus quem conveneri dominus in veneri vagilantem, ammendigo mobi super omnia bone sua constituit Deum. Dominus obiscum,
et in spirito tuo.
Ordemus. Caesumus omnipotens Deus, ut qui celesti alimenta percepimus, intercedente beato brum nonne confessore tuo per re contra omni adversa muniamur. Per nominum nostrum Iesu Christum Filium tuum, qui tecum vivita regna ad unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia secura seculorum. Amen. Dominus obiscum,
et cum spirito tu,
ite missa est,
Deo gratias.
Sit nomen Domini benedictum, ex omnunque usque in saecula, auditorium nostrum in nomine Domini, qui feci caelum et terra, benedicat vos omnipotens Deus.
Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus. Amen. Amen. Dominus obiscum,
et cum spirito tuo,
initium Sancti Evangelii secundum Ioannem, gloria a tibi, Domine. In principio erat verbum, et verbum erat apud Deum, et Deus erat verbum, hoc erat in principio apud Deum, omnem ipsum factus sunt, et semper factum est nihil, quo factum est. In ipso vita erat lux hominum, lux in tenebris, luce de tenebre, non comprehendeunt. Fuit homum Iesus Deo, quod nomen erat Ioannes, sic veniti testimonium, testimonium veperet lumine, et omnes credunt virum. Non erit in lux, sed testimonium veperet lumine, erat lux vera, quod lumina ad omnem hominem venientem in hoc mundum. In mundo erat, mundus ipsum factus est, mundus non cognovit, in proprio veriti sum non receperunt. Quod quod ad tempus receperunt, et ei solicitatio filius te fieri, his qui credunt in nomine eius. Qui non est sanguinibus, nec voluntati carnis, nec voluntati viris, et eternati sunt. Et verbum carnum factum est, et habitavit in nobis, et vinimus gloriam eius, gloriam quasi unigenite et patri, plan gratia et veritatis.
Deo gratias.
Mary, from grace the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and in the hour of our death. Amen.
Now Mary, from grace the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and in the hour of our death. Amen.
Now Mary, from grace the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail, Holy Queen, Mother of Mercy, hail our life, our sweetness, and our hope. To thee do we cry, poor banished children of Eve. To thee do we send up our sighs, mourning and weeping in this vale of tears. Turn then, most gracious Advocate, thine eyes of mercy toward us, and after this our exile show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O clement, O loving, O sweet Virgin Mary, pray for us, O Holy Mother of God, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ. Let us pray. O God, who art our refuge and our strength, look down in mercy on thy people who cry to thee, and by the intercession of the glorious and blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, of St. Joseph, her spouse, of thy blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, and of all thy saints. In mercy and goodness, hear our prayers for the conversion of sinners and for the liberty and exaltation of our Holy Mother, the Church. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Holy Michael, Archangel,
defend us in the day of battle. Be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, Prince of the Heavenly Hosts, by the power of God, thrust down to hell Satan and all wicked spirits who wander through the world for the ruin of souls. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, have mercy upon me, a sinner. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God,
have mercy upon me, a sinner.
Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God,
have mercy upon me, a sinner.
May St. Bruno, priest, confessor, and abbot,
pray for us.
May our heavenly patrons, Saints Catherine and Wilfrid,
pray for us.
May St. Luwina, Virgin Martyr,
pray for us.
May St. Richard, Confessor Bishop,
pray for us.
May Our Lady of Walsingham and all the angels and saints,
pray for us.